WFYI podcast brought to you by Bloomington, Indiana, an American college town offering food and drink, college sports, outdoor activities, live music, cool art, and good times daily. Everyone is welcome in Bloomington. More information at visitbloomington.com.
We're going to take a trip right now. Like we always do about this time.
This is a journey into sound.
Break it down.
I'm Kyle Long, and you're listening to Cultural Manifesto. March is Women's History Month, and on this week's show, we'll celebrate Women's History Month by paying tribute to the women pioneers of Hoosier music, including Vivian Carter, Anna Mae Winburn, Mary Byrne, Dena El Saffar, Priscilla Mclean, and Margaret Hillis. Women in Indiana have made historic contributions to American music, and there's no better example than Gary, Indiana's Vivian Carter. I think it's fair to say that Vivian Carter was the most influential figure in the early development of Indiana rock and roll music. In 1953, Carter co-founded Vee Jay Records in Gary, Indiana. She eventually established the label's headquarters in nearby Chicago. And in just a few years, Carter grew Vee Jay from a small independent operation into one of the most influential and successful record labels in the history of American music. Vee Jay released hit records by artists including The Impressions, The Dells, Betty Everett, and Gene Chandler.
Doop, 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 doop-a-bell, doop, doop, doop-a-bell, doop, doop, doop-a-bell, doop, doop.
In February of 1963, Vee Jay became the first American record label to issue music from the Beatles, predating the Beatles' first Capitol Records release by a year.
Last night I said these words to my girl.
Vee Jay also released important gospel and jazz music too, including the first full-length LP from the Staple Singers and the debut album from saxophonist Wayne Shorter. By the time Vee Jay closed its doors in 1966, the label had scored dozens of hits, and today Vee Jay is recognized as the most successful black-owned record label prior to the rise of Motown. Vivian Carter was born in Mississippi in 1921. Like many Southerners, Carter's family moved north, seeking opportunity during the Great Migration. Carter's family eventually settled in Gary, Indiana, where Vivian Carter graduated from Roosevelt High School. Carter didn't initially set out for a career in music, but a lucky break in 1948 sealed her fate. Chicago disc jockey Al Benson sponsored a contest for aspiring broadcasters. The winner would receive their own 15-minute program on Chicago's WGES. Carter entered and was selected as the top female entry. Carter was a hit with listeners and would go on to work at WJOB in Hammond, WGRY in Gary, and eventually she landed at WWCA in Gary, where she hosted the influential late-night radio show Living with Vivian. In 1950, Carter capitalized on her radio fame by opening Vivian's Record Shop in Gary, Indiana. By 1953, Carter had amassed an impressive set of connections in the music industry. And along with her husband, Jimmy Bracken, she seized those connections to launch Vee Jay Records. The label took its name from the couple's initials, V for Vivian and J for Jimmy. While Vee Jay Records would eventually set up shop alongside Chess and United Records on Chicago's famous Record Row, during the early days, Vee Jay Records was operated out of Vivian Carter's Gary, Indiana storefront. And while Vee Jay would one day attract national and international talent, Carter's early releases on the label were drawn almost exclusively from local Indiana talent. Carter assembled the label's early artist roster from the ranks of Gary's factory workers and high school students. This unlikely ensemble of local players laid the foundation for Vee Jay's future success and created some of the label's most enduring stars. The first record issued by Vee Jay launched the career of blues legend Jimmy Reed. Jimmy Reed was born in Mississippi in 1925. By the time Reed came to the attention of Vivian Carter, he was living in Gary, Indiana, working a day job at the local Armor meatpacking plant. Reed played harmonica, electric guitar, and sang. He had an eccentric sound that turned some listeners off, including Chess Records, who turned Reed away after an audition for the label. But Vee Jay heard potential in Reed's sound, a sound that would go on to establish Jimmy Reed as one of the most influential performers and songwriters in the history of rock and roll music. Let's listen to Reed's debut single, which was also the debut release for Vee Jay Records. From 1953, this is Jimmy Reed with High and Lonesome.
Well, now you went around the corner, oh, now come back soon. Still gonna leave me, you just wait until noon. I'm high and lonesome. Be on your merry way. Well, now you're back, don't want to leave me.
I'm Kyle Long, and you're listening to Cultural Manifesto. On this week's show, we're celebrating Women's History Month by paying tribute to the women pioneers of Hoosier music. Up next, we'll hear an excerpt from my 2018 interview with the multi-instrumentalist and composer Dena El Saffar. Dena is the founder of Salam, a Bloomington-based Middle Eastern music ensemble. The music of Salam draws from El Saffar's Iraqi heritage. For over 30 years, Salam have educated audiences around the country about the music and culture of Iraq. Let's listen to an excerpt from our conversation. During this time in Bloomington, in the mid-late 90s, there was a very vibrant live music scene, and it was getting some attention. And Salam was getting some significant attention at that time as well. I think it was 1996. The group was featured on the cover of Billboard magazine in a story called Indiana, the New Music Haven, right?
It's so true.
Yeah.
So
tell me about the early days of the group and kind of your place in that Bloomington scene and whether or not that attention that was, for a moment, being placed on Bloomington really attracted any sort of meaningful opportunities for the group.
I would call it one more pebble.
Yeah.
As everything winds up just being one more pebble. It was certainly really exciting, especially for like the people in our family that are not big music fans that are like, well, call me when you're playing at the Grand Ole Opry. Like, they just like, for them, it was like to see us on the cover was like, oh, well, I guess they might be good or something. The 90s, I think, were a really good time for bands, for CDs, for albums, for music sales. And so there was a really vibrant feeling at that time. And I think Bloomington was a really thriving place at that time. We actually, out of that Billboard, we got approached by a couple different music labels. And then we'd look at the fine print and be like, okay, wow, no thank you. We'll just keep on making our own albums.
Thank you. And Dena, Salam embraces a lot of different traditions of Middle Eastern music, right? Certainly Iraqi music has been at the forefront of the group's sort of image and sound with your Iraqi-American heritage. This is a really sad and depressing question to ask, but I think it's an important question, and I'm curious for your thoughts on this. You know, I can't help but notice the history of Salam has paralleled the utter and total destruction of the nation and in some ways the culture of Iraq through a series of ongoing wars and conflicts that never seems to end. Tell me about that, and how does that impact the work you're doing with Salam?
Thank you for saying that so kindly. I mean, it's really a sensitive thing, and it's really something that, in a way, when you get all involved in the music, it's a comfort to just be able to focus on something so beautiful. And it's a way to respond also to what's all the awfulness in the and in fact, you're right. Like, that's not a coincidence. I think the first Gulf War that started in 1991 galvanized my feelings because it was so I felt so helpless. And also, like, I'm not a doctor or a nurse. I can't go and stitch wounds or something. I'm here sawing away at a viola. Like, what is this? And I thought, well, okay, maybe I can do something kind of broader. Like, I really wanted to just do something to, like, heal the hurt that I felt in the world. And it turned out, like, music could work if I really focused it and brought this beautiful musical culture to kind of, like, well, I don't want to call it the perpetrator exactly because it's very complex, like how it all went down. And I mean, the government in Iraq was not good when all this stuff started. But I mean, I'm not making excuses either. It's just it's complex. And I'm no politician. And what I do feel like I'm put on this earth to bring beauty into the world. And that I look around and I see all this stuff that I can't do much about. But hey, I'll do my job and what I think I was put here for, which is, so in terms of presenting Iraqi music to an American public, that has been really wonderful for me. I feel like Americans have been incredibly receptive to our music, curious and enthusiastic. And the 25 years that we've existed is completely because American audiences have supported a Middle Eastern band that lives in the Midwest. So it's very complex, but very and ultimately beautiful, actually, in some ways.
Yeah. And one thing I love about the group, Dena and Tim, is during these the aftermath of 9/11, when there was a lot of xenophobia and hysteria about anything coming out of the Middle East, right? During that time, you both used this music as a way of educating people, and you're going into schools, and you were doing this real significant outreach to educate people on this culture and these traditions. Tell me about that aspect of your work, the outreach and really being ambassadors to kind of undo all this miseducation and propaganda we get in this country that really distorts people's minds about who people from Iraq are or who people from Saudi Arabia are or whatever the case may be. Yeah.
Well, I mean, funny that when I was growing up, when we would do these little like lineages or heritages about as sort of school projects, and I'd say my dad was from Iraq, and kids would say, what, where, huh? You know, and then by the time I was a young adult, everybody had heard that name so much and associated with something bad or like terrorism. And so I also remember as a fifth grader being really confused about what I am because of other kids saying, you're this, you're that. And I thought, oh, gosh, are we even Americans? Like, I was really confused. And so I kind of wanted to, like, see if I could fix that by showing up to schools and being like, okay, kids, Mesopotamia, you're probably going to hear about in history. It's the Tigris and the Euphrates. This is Iraq. Look at the Tigris and the Euphrates still flowing through it. And just, like, make all the connections and do it in a really fun, engaging way with music. And, I mean, what made me so happy is, like, we're playing folkloric Iraqi music for like, little elementary school kids in southern Indiana, and they're just, like, instantly started clapping along. Like, they don't care where it's from. They just like good music. And it just felt like it just, like, disintegrated barriers, using music as the key to open up these doors.
Next, we'll listen to the title track from Salaam's 2013 album, Train to Basra. That was Salaam with Train to Basra. This week on Cultural Manifesto, we're celebrating Women's History Month by paying tribute to the women pioneers of Hoosier music. Up next, we'll focus on Anna Mae Winburn. She was raised in Kokomo, Indiana, and gained national fame as the bandleader and vocalist for the International Sweethearts of Rhythm, a trailblazing, multiracial, all-female big band that was active from 1937 to 1949. The band's story was told in a 1986 documentary titled International Sweethearts of Rhythm, America's Hottest All-Girl Band. Anna Mae Winburn was interviewed for the film, and she recalled the famous musicians who supported the band.
Louis Armstrong was one of our very dearest friends, you know. He took a personal interest in the band, and so did Count Basie. Count Basie was the same way. They would come and stand in the wings at the Apollo Theater and listen to the band. They'd get a big bang. I'd see him standing back there smiling when they'd hear the girls take off on their instruments. Whenever we would appear in the theater, we weren't just playing our own music. We had to play the act's music, and we were the Paradise Theater with Ella Fitzgerald. She told her agent, I don't think those girls can play my music. I don't think they can cut my repertoire. So we rehearsed, and the show went off very smoothly. And from then on, she got to be a very good friend.
Up next, we'll hear a live recording from the International Sweethearts of Rhythm, featuring Anna Mae Winburn on vocals. This is Jump Children.
When you're feeling low and you don't know what to do, when you're feeling low and you don't know what to do, just stay in the groove, let nothing bother you. I may be small, but baby, have no fear.
Cultural Manifesto will return after this short break.
WFYI podcast brought to you by Bloomington, Indiana, an American college town offering food and drink, college sports, outdoor activities, live music, cool art, and good times daily. Everyone is welcome in Bloomington. More information at visitbloomington.com.
I'm Kyle Long, and you're listening to Cultural Manifesto. On this week's show, we're celebrating Women's History Month by paying tribute to the women pioneers of Hoosier music. Up next, we'll hear an excerpt of my 2021 interview with Mary Byrne. Mary is best known for her work as an activist in the LGBTQ+ community, but she's also an important figure in Indiana music. Mary Byrne is the founder of Labyrinth, an influential feminist lesbian nightclub that operated in downtown Indianapolis from 1978 to 1984. During the 1980s, Mary also served as director of the National Women's Music Festival in Bloomington, Indiana. Byrne's work, creating stages for women performers in Indiana was unprecedented at the time and remains a significant achievement in the history of Indiana music. Let's listen back to an excerpt from our conversation as Mary recalls the opening of Labyrinth in the late 1970s.
So I just started meeting all of these women and feminists, and there was only this dark, dungy place down on South Street called Darlow's. And I just felt like women needed a place to go that reflected positive and good vibes and things like that. So that I kind of started learning. I got a job at Waffle House and started learning how to do food and, you know, cost of sales and that sort of thing. And then I went to a bartending school, got a job as a bartender for a while. I knew exactly where I wanted it located and watched the papers, and bingo, there it was. It was a country music tavern that I tried to run over the winter. I was not a bar person, and I thought that, of course, winters would be the slow time during a bar season. And, you know, no, it's not. Summer is slow because you've got millions of other things to do. And so I kept it as a country music tavern through, I think, the end of December, so like maybe 2 months. And then I realized that my staff was ripping me off. And so I just closed it, cleaned it, and renovated it, and got the word out. We opened in March. And on our opening night, one of my friends came to me and said, I think we have problems in the parking lot. And I went out, and there were 28 slashed tires on 24 cars. So I had to come back into this party and say, hey, we got to stop. Everybody has to help everybody else change tires. Come back in, and we'll have a party. So that was kind of the way it started, and it was all good from there.
Mary Byrne developed a number of tactics to help protect her clientele at Labyrinth. I heard you employed a few different tactics. You had a membership card that women would receive that were regulars. And you also would sometimes institute an absurdly high door fee to get in if you were trying to kind of weed people out. Yeah, tell me about some of the things you did to kind of, like I said, protect your clientele. And
well, when you first walked in the door, I built this L-shaped hallway that you came down, and there was a window and a door, and that door into the bar was always locked coming in, and it was always unlocked going out. So it was not a safety problem. But we got a chance to see who was coming in the bar. And at that point, at the very beginning, we were trying to figure out a way that we could kind of prioritize women and weed out people that were going to be there that could cause trouble. And after a while, well, the membership thing wasn't really, I found out that it wasn't really legal or kosher, so we didn't do that anymore. And neither really was the door charge, but we did do that. But then after a while, it just was a matter of that we saw, a guy and a woman come in, and we were just very frank. It says, this is a women's bar, and if everybody acts appropriately, please come in. So, because there was also a thing that I was dealing with at the time, that the word feminism and feminist was a really was derogatory almost. It was not a good thing. And there was another women's bar in town, and they, maybe it was because I was infringing on some of their clientele, which wouldn't really be the case, but they kind of circulated it that we hated men. You know, that's always the thing. You can't be pro-women unless you hate men, and that was not the case at all. So we did have to deal with kind of internal gay politics things. Because the other point is, it was very definitely a feminist bar. Now, granted, I'd say substantial number of people, women that came down, were lesbians, but not all.
Before opening Labyrinth, Mary Byrne had very little experience in the local music scene. I asked Mary if she intended to create a music venue when she opened Labyrinth.
No, I don't think I set out to make it a music venue, but right around that time, late 70s, is when the National Women's Music Festival was starting over in Champaign. We had gone to the Michigan Women's Music Festival maybe a year or two, and so my eyes were opening to what was to be called women's music, or how music performed by, written by women could have such a positive effect on women's lives. And so it just made sense, and it was also a great way to get a crowd in.
You know, when I look at your life and everything you've accomplished, to me, I see music as having a big place in all that. And I think your achievements within the field of music in Indiana are really extraordinary. But I'm curious, you know, how you see that aspect of your work. And was that something that you really had much of an interest in prior to opening Labyrinth? Were you a big music fan? Were you really tuned in to what was happening in music, going to concerts? Was this an area you ever kind of expected or wanted to get into prior to this?
No. Yeah. No, but the point was community and community building. And this music and going to these festivals, listening to this, was an incredible community building thing. I produced 3 or 4 concerts before I opened the bar, just to get a sense of whether or not women would come and support something like that. And they were very popular. And it got women to, because I would talk about opening the bar at these concerts. And the last one was a Holly Near concert that we had out at Brebeuf. And I just told them, okay, got the bar. I've been talking about this. You've been asking what you can do to help. So now I need your help.
And Mary, you know, my final question to you is, I'm curious how you assess your impact on music in Indiana and in Indianapolis. To me, you had a huge impact, and it's really hard to even kind of wrap my head around all the things you were doing and things you were involved in. You know, not only did you create a platform for women's music here in the state, you created a safe space for openly gay women performers to, you know, share their art with people here, something that I don't know how tangible that was for these performers prior to some of the stages you created. Looking back on this, how do you assess your impact in the music scene here in Indiana?
I think that the music had a mammoth impact on both individual women. I mean, that's why I got into it. I started hearing this music, and it spoke to me. It was the thing that started healing, you know, all the garbage I'd heard about myself since I was young. That I didn't fit in, that I wasn't worth enough, that I was not beautiful, that I was, you know, you heard all the stuff. And here is this music that it just makes you whole. It starts that healing thing. And I think that that music touched every individual woman's life. So in one way, that just, you know, that all of those people got to experience that, and then the idea that you could form a community around that music, and again reinforce that positiveness, you know, weekly by getting together with your friends or whatever. It's had a profound influence on me and my life, and I know on other women.
Many local musicians performed at Labyrinth and the National Women's Music Festival during the 1980s, including Software, an all-female synth rock band based in Indianapolis. Up next, we'll hear a song from Software's 1984 self-titled cassette. This is Software with Plastic World. I'm Kyle Long, and you're listening to Cultural Manifesto. On this week's show, we're celebrating Women's History Month by paying tribute to the women pioneers of Hoosier music. Up next, we'll listen to an excerpt from my 2021 interview with the electronic music composer Priscilla Mclean. Priscilla studied at IU Bloomington during the late 1960s, and during the 1970s, Priscilla created groundbreaking electronic music works at IU South Bend. Priscilla was among the first Hoosier women to attain national notoriety in the world of electronic music. Let's listen to an excerpt from our conversation. First, I just wondered if you'd like to share a little bit about how you became interested in electronic music. I know you'd studied more traditional forms of European art music and classical music in your youth. How did you become interested in electronic music?
Well, it began at Indiana University when I was working on. I took a doctoral course one summer when my husband was finishing his doctorate there. And there was a course in electronic music. And I wasn't at all interested in electronic music. I wanted nothing to do with it. And I was intrigued but horrified by what I heard. I was very conservative. So we went to Indiana University in the summertime. I had graduated from there, and Bart was graduating also, and finally got this one course. Ioannis Xenakis was the director. We never saw him, but we worked with Michael Babcock, who directed the class, and Jay Williams, who showed us the Moog synthesizer, that they had one Moog synthesizer and a four-channel Ampex tape recorder. It was a small studio. And I was working there for about one day, and I just was fascinated by the sounds I was getting. I didn't really know what I was doing, but I just fell in love with the medium, creating all these new sounds. And there were just all these new, interesting sounds that you never really thought of as music, but in the electronic medium, it was acceptable. I liked the idea that I could create something that wasn't, you know, just walking in the footsteps of all the great male composers, which I found intimidating and not terribly interesting. This way, I could create something new and, you know, hopefully getting better as I did it, that people would want to hear and get excited by and just create it. It's like creating a painting or creating a new art form, as Mort Subotnick used to say, it was creating a sound sculpture. You were sculpting the sound and creating, you know, a musical sculpture. So this is all very fascinating. So that's how I got started.
You mentioned you weren't initially interested in electronic music, and it sounds like you might have had an unfavorable reaction to it at one point. Was it through the process of experimenting with it yourself that you kind of learned to appreciate it, or?
Well, partially that. It did start with tinkering around with that Moog synthesizer, but there were some pieces out there I was fascinated by. There was one by, well, Yanisunakis. Let's see, what was it? It was called Orient-Occident. He'd written it for a film. And this was on a recording. And I just played that over and over and over. It was very nature-oriented. And I was fascinated by that. Mort Subotnick had a piece called Silver Apples of the Moon. That was, I think, his first recording.
Priscilla, you mentioned studying at Indiana University. There was a program established there by the famous composer Yanis Xenakis, as you mentioned. It's now known as the Center for Electronic and Computer Music, but at the time, I believe it was the Center for Mathematical and Automated Music. And there was such a distaste for electronic music during this time period that I understand they didn't want Xenakis to create this electronic music program through the School of Music, and it had to be in a completely different department of the university. Is that true? And could you kind of describe the atmosphere around this music at IU at that time?
You have to remember, I was very young, and this is all very new to me. And I only met him once. I met him as he was speaking to a group of us in the auditorium. That's the only time I ever saw Mr. Xenakis. But they did not want him teaching composition students in electronic music. They felt that they were threatened. And boy, this is not the only time these people have been threatened. They've been threatened by my husband's work and, you know, maybe even mine. They were threatened by the music. They wanted to stick to their opera, which was their famous for that school music that they were teaching. And what he was creating, when he really was quite way out, just scared them to death. And they felt, since he had been hired, that he has to teach something, so let him teach the mathematical students. And they could study beginning computer with him, but not any composers. So that's what happened there.
Priscilla, you mentioned there being sort of fear or hostility towards electronic music at IU during the 1960s, late 1960s and early 70s. It seems like that was kind of maybe how the public at large felt about electronic music at that time. You know, obviously now electronic music is commonplace and part of everything we hear on the radio and TV. How do you feel about this kind of rapid expansion of this music during your lifetime? Any thoughts on that?
Well, I feel that in the past, back in the late 60s, it was something so new that people either reacted, you know, oh boy, this is some new idea, can't wait to hear this, or, oh, yeah, this threatens classical music. It's already being threatened by pop music and jazz and all this stuff. What's going to happen to classical music? It's going to die out if these people are abandoning instruments and going into work on synthesizers.
I want to go back to something you said earlier in our conversation. You mentioned that when you were a composition student, you weren't interested in walking in the footsteps of all these male composers. You know, and in your book, you mentioned, you know, facing some opposition from your male counterparts to pursuing a degree or pursuing your studies in composition. Did you see electronic music as sort of a new frontier away from this male-dominated world of orchestral music? Yeah.
Yeah, well, I didn't think of it in those terms. That may have been true, but I didn't think of it that way. I was just, at first, very hostily against it for the same reason everybody else was. We used to laugh at it when I was in Massachusetts working on my undergraduate degree. You know, you'd hear an electronic piece and everybody'd break out laughing. So I had a very dim view of it in those days. And when I found out by experiencing it myself how fascinating it was, I really didn't care what anybody else thought.
I'm Kyle Long, and you're listening to Cultural Manifesto. On this week's show, we're celebrating Women's History Month by paying tribute to the women pioneers of Hoosier music. Up next, we'll focus on Margaret Hillis, one of the most prominent Hoosier musicians of the 20th century. Margaret Hillis was an influential figure in American choral music and a trailblazing pioneer for women in classical music. Hillis is best remembered as the founder and director of the Chicago Symphony Chorus. She led the ensemble from 1957 to 1994 and won 9 Grammy Awards for her work with the chorus. She was born in Kokomo, Indiana, on October 1st of 1921. Hillis was born into a prominent Indiana family. Her grandfather, Elwood Haynes, was a successful inventor, and her father, Glenn Hillis, was a notable Indiana politician. Let's hear an excerpt of a 1979 interview Hillis recorded with Chicago's WTTW as she recalls her early years in Kokomo.
When did you start your musical interests?
Well, my grandmother had a pipe organ in her home, and the pipes were downstairs in the basement. And at one end of this very large living room, there was grill work as part of the floor. And I'm told that when I was 6 months old, I would crawl out in the middle of that grill work, and as she played the organ, I'd sit there and conduct. That may have been when it started.
Yeah, that's a fairly decent sign.
Yes.
And then you went on to play several musical instruments,
yes,
did you not?
I started the study of piano at the age of 5. And we had a very overworked music supervisor in the public schools.
This is in Kokomo, Indiana.
In Kokomo, Indiana. So he often had to be away from a rehearsal for a little while. So we'd trade instruments. And I tootled away on the trumpet, on the French horn. I did take French horn lessons. I played double bass, and that only because he didn't have any double basses in the high school orchestra. He needs them. So I said, all right, I'll play it, knowing nothing about it. But I figured out from the tuning where what things were. And then when I went to Indiana University, I played well enough that I was the principal bass there.
Did you sing much growing up?
Some. When I was 16, I had about a year of voice lessons, and then I again studied voice when I was in college.
We'll end this week's show with an early recording from Margaret Hillis. Before founding the Chicago Symphony Chorus, Hillis led the New York Concert Choir. We'll hear an excerpt of a 1954 recording of Hillis in the New York Concert Choir performing Igor Stravinsky's Cantata. You can find more programs documenting the history of women pioneers in Hoosier music on the Cultural Manifesto podcast at WFYI.org or wherever you listen to podcasts. Cultural Manifesto is hosted and produced by me, Kyle Long. Thank you for listening.